Hey guys, I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about the aftermath of Christopher Columbus. What happens when he gets back to Spain from this great voyage? The first question that people begin to ask is, does somebody own the Americas? Can it be property? And if it can, who in fact owns it? So the first people that think they actually own it would be the people that were there originally. Native Latin American people, the Incas, the Mayas, the Aztec. Hey, I was here first, why wouldn't I own it? Well, Europeans strictly disagree with that. Europeans think they have the right to own Latin America. And they actually get in disputes between specific countries, like Spain and Portugal argue over who owns certain sections of Latin America, even though they're hundreds of miles away. So I want to talk a little bit about the specifics of that. The first example I have for you is the Treaty of Tordesillas, and I think this example best shows how Europeans actually go out of their way to call Latin America theirs and to take it away from Latin Americans. First of all, let me give you a little background as to what a treaty is. If you don't know, a treaty is basically an agreement between two groups. It's basically a negotiation to solve a problem or a conflict they're having. Tordesillas is just a city in Spain. It's where this negotiation takes place. So the Treaty of Tordesillas was all about Europeans claiming the Americas for Europe, not for Latin America. And the two groups that are fighting over who owns Latin America and this newfound land are Portugal and Spain. Basically, the disagreement starts when the Spanish, because they funded Christopher Columbus finding the New World, Christopher Columbus comes back to Spain, and Spain says, hey, I own all this new land to the west. If you look at your map, everything in the Americas, Spain basically claimed for themselves. They hadn't found all of it yet, but they basically said, hey, if I do find it, it's going to be mine because we got there first. So they begin to do that. The Portuguese don't agree with that at all. They say, hey, wait a minute, you may have found that little area, you know, in the Caribbean and the tips of South America, in some of Central America. Yeah, Columbus got there first, but that doesn't necessarily mean you own all of it. The Portuguese begin to say, wait a minute, let's negotiate something here. Maybe we can find a treaty between the two of us. And so they get, actually, the Pope to help them. If you don't know, the Pope is the head of the Catholic Church. The Pope is like a title. It's like saying the King of the Catholic Church. The Pope at the time decides that he's going to help out the Portuguese and the Spanish solve their conflict and negotiate this treaty. The Portuguese and Spanish basically end up agreeing that they're going to move this line, this dividing line, to where the solid purple line is. And it basically says that, hey, the Spanish get everything on this side, the west side of the purple line, and the Portuguese get everything on the east side of the purple line. All the new colonies on the east side will be the Portuguese. At first glance, it may occur to you that, hey, wait a minute, Spain's getting a whole lot of land here. Well, first of all, you have to consider the fact that neither the Portuguese, the Spanish, or the Pope knew how much land was here. They had no way of knowing that, for example, California was there. They had only sailed to the nearest coast to them, which was places like Cuba, or Panama, or Colombia. They didn't know about places like Alaska, for example, or even Canada. So the Portuguese don't know they're giving all this land to Spain. What the Portuguese do know is that, hey, I'm getting the tip of South America, so there's a chance I can have more land that I don't know about. And I'm also going to get all of Africa for colonies that the Spanish are pretty interested in at the time as well. So Portugal feels like they're getting a pretty good end of the deal. They're getting half the globe, and Spain's getting half the globe. In the end, it turns out that Spain gets the better deal because they have more land on the west side of the line. But neither group knows that. The Pope actually probably makes out the best in this whole deal. For his job in negotiating this treaty, the Portuguese and the Spanish say, hey, no matter who finds the new colonies, we're going to make sure that they're all Christian. We're going to make sure all of these people are Catholic. And so that's great for the Pope because he gets to spread his religion, and that's more people he gets to tell what to do. So notice who's not at this treaty, who's not at this meeting of Tordesillas. And that's pretty obvious. It's the Latin Americans. You don't see Aztecs. You don't see Incas. You definitely don't see Mayans. None of these Latin American people get to come and negotiate who owns the land they live on. And that's done on purpose. So that's important to make note of. Europe feels like they own this new land, not Latin America. Excuse me. So as the years go on, within 100 years, Europe begins to divide up Latin America. And this is the map just 100 years after Columbus finds rediscovers Latin America. You can see the majority of the map is Spanish. All the yellow, they call New Spain. And it goes from everywhere from North America, what's today, like, you can see parts of California, Arizona, Mexico, and all the way down through Central America, almost to the tip of South America in Argentina and Chile today. So the Spanish get a great end of this deal. They own most of the land in Latin America with their colonies. But if you notice that little tip of South America, the Portuguese actually end up settling there. And they get a lot of strong colonies on the coast of South America directly from the Treaty of Tordesillas. Not many other groups are represented here. There's definitely not Latin Americans. And most of the other European countries, like the French and the British, decide they're going to concentrate their efforts on Northern America. So Latin America really gets divided up between the two major groups, Spain and Portugal. Latin Americans don't get any say in this, and they definitely don't get to control their own governments or their own people. They're told what to do. So this actually has a big impact on our world today. If you look at the globe, there's evidence that the Treaty of Tordesillas actually changed the globe completely. The first example I'm going to show you is the map you see on your screen about Christianity. Before Christopher Columbus arrived, this map would have looked very, very different. You would have seen a whole lot of native Latin American religions. We talked a lot about how the Aztecs and the Mayans and the Incas had their very own unique gods. They were polytheistic. It meant they believed in more than one god. But afterwards, after all this colonization from Europe, and after Spain and Portugal claim this land, they all convert this area to Christianity. Remember back to the Treaty of Tordesillas when the Pope said, hey, you guys can claim whatever land you want. I don't care as long as you make it Christian. And that's exactly what they did. And as a result, if you look at the map today, almost every country in Latin America is entirely Christian. They all believe in one Christian God. They're monotheistic. Everywhere from Mexico all the way down to the tips of Chile and Argentina. And you can even see some countries are more Christian than others, but almost all of them have a strong showing of Christianity. The other example that you can see on the influence of the Treaty of Tordesillas is in the language that people speak today. Almost all of Latin America speaks one of two languages, either Spanish or Portuguese. Brazil, who's a huge country, one of the biggest countries in the world by land area and population, speaks almost entirely Portuguese. Notice it's on the tip of the South American coast that was given to the Portuguese. But the rest of Latin America pretty much speaks Spanish. And you can see that from the tip of South America all the way through Central America, in the Caribbean, in even parts of North America, speak almost entirely Spanish. So the Spanish and the Portuguese, and basically this Treaty of Tordesillas, have a huge impact on the culture of Latin America and the way people live their everyday lives. Everything down from religion, to the gods they pray to the languages they speak. So the last thing and the last thought I really want to leave you with is, wait a minute, are Latin Americans just going to sit back and take all of this? Are they going to let Europeans boss them around and tell them how to speak and how to eat and how to pray? Are they going to put up with Europeans saying, hey, Latin America belongs to Europe? And the simple answer to this is no. Latin Americans start to stand up to Europeans and they start to say, I don't want this. Latin America should belong to Latin Americans, not Europeans. And so there's four individuals that we're going to look at specifically in the coming days that really prove this. And I've listed them on your screen. You have Toussaint Louverture. You have Miguel Hidalgo and his wife Manuela Sáñez, Simón Bolívar, and even a more modern example, Fidel Castro. All of these Latin American people really have a hatred of Europeans. So they do everything in their power to liberate Latin America or to free it. So we'll be talking about these four individuals in the coming days. All right, that's it for now.